I really did not like sandboxes as a kid. It's not that I have a problem with sand, or sand on the beach, or sand castles, just sand boxes. See, as a little kid, I'd play with something, then I'd kind of forget about it, and then rediscover it, and it'd be all new again. This is what happened with my sandbox. Except, when I rediscovered it, the sand had all these tiny holes in it. My dad was with me and exclaimed, "Why, look at that! Your sandbox is full of antlions!" Perhaps my dad should not have assumed that I knew what antlions were. I eventually figured out what they were later on, and it makes sense now because my father really loves insects. Antlions are insects. In their adult form, they sort of look, in my personal opinion, like a less cool version of a dragonfly. They are not a dragonfly. But in their larva stage, they look, well, not like many things I can compare it to. They have these mandibles and they make these sandpit traps. And then they wait with their mandibles just showing above the surface. When an ant or other small insect walks over their sandpit, they drag it in. They pull the ant underground, biting it and injecting it with enzymes to digest it in order to consume the ant's juices. I also have learned by watching them that they toss sand at their ant victim too if they need help subduing it before they drag them under. Thankfully, antlions are small. In fact, doodlebug is evidently another name for these things. I'm not exactly sure how you go from antlion to doodlebug, but okay. It's all relative. They're bad news for an ant, because the antlion is a predator of the ant. The ant is their prey. That's an ecological relationship right there. And that's what we're going to talk about, ecological relationships. Typically, if we were to graph the predator and prey populations in our example, when the population of ants in this confined area increase, it is likely that the antlions, which are the predators, also will increase over time because they have more food to eat. However, if the antlions increase too much, there won't be enough ants, which are the prey, to feed on, so the antlions will decrease. You can see that relationship in this predator and prey graph. In most ecosystems, predator and prey graphs go up and down frequently. It cycles. Also, just because this antlion is a predator doesn't mean that this is the only role it plays. An antlion can get eaten by a bird. Now the antlion has just become the bird's prey. Competition is also another relationship to consider. Antlions are consumers, which means they have to eat other things. They can't make their own food. They have to compete with other antlions for this food too, this food being their prey, the ants. This example shows competition for a limiting biotic factor. And they're not just competing with other antlions for this biotic factor. They may have to compete with completely different species in the area that are also predators of ants too. For example, jumping spiders like ants. You know, it's not just consumers that compete. Producers, like this plant, make their own food, but that does not mean they don't have to deal with competition. For example, this plant here is competing for this limiting abiotic factor, light. Symbiotic relationships are specific types of relationships where different species live together. Parasitism is an example of a symbiotic relationship where one organism benefits and the other is harmed. An example? Well, you know, I love dogs. Petunia is the cat person. When my family took in our rescue dog, she was 4 months old at the time. We learned from the vet that she would need to be treated for fleas and hookworms. We were able to give her medicine to treat these parasites. A good thing, because these parasites can hurt the dog by feeding on their blood. A parasite is an organism that gets its nutrients from another organism and causes harm to its host. They can live inside or on their host. Mutualism is an example of a symbiotic relationship where both organisms involved benefit. You really need to look up a video about acacia ants and acacia trees because this is a fascinating example. See, some species of acacia trees form these hollow thorns which provide housing to acacia ants. Some species even provide a nectar for food for these ants. So, what does this tree get in return? Protection. I'd hate to be a type of consumer that eats acacia trees because if it has acacia ants, the ants will come out of the thorns and attack the consumer. They'll even destroy plants that try to grow close to the acacia tree so the ants can eliminate the tree's competition. Nice mutual relationship between the acacia tree and the acacia ant. The last symbiotic relationship we'll mention is commensalism. This one is interesting because in this relationship, one organism benefits and the other is neither helped nor harmed. It has a neutral effect. Some species of barnacles and whales are a great example. Many barnacle species can attach themselves to moving things, like a boat or a whale. On a free whale ride, the barnacles get a lot of access to food since they are filter feeders and the whale may travel to nutrient-rich waters. In this particular example, the barnacles benefit, but neither help nor harm the whale, so this would be commensalism. But I do like to remind my students that sometimes there's more to the story with a relationship labeled as commensalism, and sometimes what we thought was a completely neutral effect may not always be in every case. So why do all these relationships matter anyway? Well, one reason is that these interactions can make significant impacts on populations of different species living together. That means if the population of a certain species is threatened by human activity, for example, it can affect more than just that one species. Scientists continue to learn about new ecological relationships all the time. Well, that's it for the Amoeba Sisters, and we remind you to stay curious.